Good day. Hope you have liked my videos. If you have find it very much informative, kindly like all those videos and subscribe to this YouTube channel so that you can easily access to all my forthcoming videos. So with respect to the large number of the queries which are generally being asked in various social networking sites, I have made this video on step-by-step procedure for getting the divorce under the provisions of the Hindu Marriage Act. So I have made some questionnaires which you find it very much informative if you access to all these questionnaires. So kindly see all these questionnaires which are arranged in a sequential manner. If you have watched my videos related to the grounds of getting the divorce, you can find it as a supplement, because the majority of the queries have usually been based on how these proceedings are being carried out, and what are the procedures which one has to be followed while filing the application for getting the divorce. So this is my English version of the for all those viewers, especially those who are living in southern areas who are not easily accessed to the Hindi language. So this is my step-by-step procedure in getting the divorce filed by the husband or the wife under the Hindu Marriage Act. So normally, suppose if someone wants to file a case of a divorce, what are the procedure aspects? What procedure has to be followed? So I have tried to discuss all those procedure aspects in this video. So number one is that the petition should only be filed if there are grounds of divorce and the burden of the proof lies on the party who seeks the divorce. But normally what happens, so suppose if both the parties are not residing for so many years, and one of the party has caused cruelty, desertion, and suppose one party has played a fraud on the other party. So if there are the grounds of the divorce, then only one should proceed in filing the petition for the divorce. Now question arises, where to file? So majority of the people have asked, we have obtained a degree through some power attorney, or by some notary. Will it going to be help? Suppose if we get it signed from the notary. So no, it's not admissible. Legally, it's not admissible. You have to file an application only in the family court or in the court of the additional district judge. If you are filing a case, if the marriage takes place under the Hindu Marriage Act, there is a specific act is there. This is called the Hindu Marriage Act. I hope you have watched that my video which relates to the divorce, the grounds of the divorce. If you have not watched that video, I will put that link in the description box. You can easily access to that video. So if the marriage took place under the Hindu customs, so you have to seek the divorce. There's only one remedy, is that is to obtain a divorce either by the family court or by the court of the additional district judge. Now a question arises, jurisdiction of the court, where one can file a case. Suppose that both the parties are residing. Suppose one party is residing in Delhi, another party is residing in the Calcutta or Chennai, wheresoever. Where one can file? What is the jurisdiction of this court? Suppose if the matrimony, there are three options are there. Whether if one of the parties is residing in a particular place, the party can go and file a case of divorce where the opposite party resides, or where the matrimonial house is located, or where the petitioner resides. Suppose if the husband is interested in seeking the divorce against the wife, or the wife is seeking the divorce against the husband, where any of the party is residing in a particular place, he or she has got the liberty to file a case where one of the party is currently residing or where the matrimonial house is located. This is the jurisdiction of the court. So can the case be transferred? Yes, obviously the case can be transferred, but you have to file a transfer petition there in the appropriate court. Suppose if you are residing in particular state, if you want to transfer from one district to another district, then only the high court has got the power to transfer the case from one district jurisdiction to another district jurisdiction. And suppose if you want to get the case transferred from one state to another state, if you are residing in Karnataka, if you want to transfer the case into the Odisha, So only the Supreme Court has got the power to file to transfer the case from one state to another. For this, you have to file an application on have to file a transfer petition in the Supreme Court. So normally, there's the hidden truth is there. Only the wife applications are usually get allowed or get entertained because it's convenient. The law presumes that it's very difficult for a woman to travel from one place to another place. So the husband players are hardly get entertained unless some strong grounds are there. Suppose if the husband is handicapped or if he has if the wife doesn't have any children, of the children are residing with the husband. So then only in such cases the plea of the husband is usually get entertained. But in very rare case, so if the cases, so one should be very much careful. If you are a husband, if you want to get the case transferred, if you have very very strong grounds, then only then you proceed to transfer the case from one district or from one state to the another state. Hope this has been clear. And now question arises, how to file a case? See, after the enactment of the family court, so only the parties have got the liberty to file their own cases. The advocates are the barred in appearing before the courts unless the courts granted some liberty or grants the application of the advocates are allowed. So but these applications has to be filed by the party itself. So first thing is that the party must have to be appeared in person. So advocates are not allowed to appear on the very first day of the hearing unless the court issues the directions or grants the leave to the party that he or she can be appeared through a counsel. For this, as I said earlier, that he has to file an application under the provisions of the Family Court Act, that is the section 13. So now question arises, how to file? So for seeking any divorce, you have to file the requisite amount of the required amount of the copies you have to file, and court fees and some supporting documents along with the residential proof as per the guidelines or the directions issued by the various family courts from time to time. Suppose if they ask for some photographs, you have to furnish the photographs. If they ask for some residential proof, you have to furnish the residential proof documents supporting the document that you are residing here. So the filing counter will generally scrutinize these application and the required documents. So you have to approach to that family court where the matrimonial house is located or where the any of the parties is currently residing. So we have to file the required number of the copies, court fees and the supporting documents with it. So what is the format? The question arises, what is the format of that petition? Large number of the people usually ask how we have to draft this petition. See, there is no exact format, but as compared to the other petitions which especially if you file cases under the CPC, Civil Procedure Code, and some other related cases, is the format? Is the format is just you have to file an index, you have to draft the petition, and the petition must contain the facts of the cases, and there must be a grounds of the divorce must be there. So have to draft the petition. If you can take sample petition, you can get the sample from various sources available on the internet or from the how to draft petitions. The model form of the petitions are available in various standard books. You can see all those formats and can get the petition draft in the same manner. So the petition must have the index, and it must also contains the status of the parties, the case title details and the status of the parties prior to this marriage, what was their status, where they have been residing. You have to disclose each and everything, and after the marriage where both the parties are residing. And so these are the current status must have to be disclosed in the petition. And most important thing is the cause of action. Cause of action must have to be stated very clearly. If without cause of action, the divorce petition will never be entertained. So first thing is the index. If you can also file the list of dates and events, you can file the list of dates and events, but it's not been preferable because list of dates and events are only been filed in the writ petition and other things. After this, the petition must be drafted. you have to mention, to describe about yourself, details of the opposite parties, current status of the parties, facts of the cases in a chronological manner, where the marriage took place, where the parties have been deciding, and what exactly has happened during the marriage, why you want to seek the divorce. You have to narrate all the facts in a systematic manner, and then the grounds of the divorce must have to be pleaded. Without ground of divorce, the petition will never be entertained because it becomes a part of the record. So you have to draft the petition in a very careful manner. So the cause of action must have to be disclosed. Suppose the cause of action is continuing in nature, you have to disclose its continuing in nature. Opposite party has caused cruelty, or opposite party has deserted you. So you have to disclose each and everything, the cause of action, in a very careful manner. And the declaration must to be there. So you have to declare in a very visual manner. Suppose if you have filed any petition there, you have to disclose this fact. If you have filed any other petition, you have to disclose this fact. If there is no petition, it's pending there. If you are filing this petition for the first time, you have to make a declaration that no other case is pending there. I have not approached to any other court, including the High Court and the Supreme Court. You have to make this declaration. After this declaration, you have to state clearly that this court has got the jurisdiction to entertain this case, and the jurisdiction clause must have to be added there. And after the cause of action declaration, and jurisdiction clause must have to be added. Then the prayer. Then is the prayer. The prayer must to be without prayer, the petition is not being entertained. So you have to disclose the prayer, what exactly you have been seeking for. The prayer clause must be carefully drafted. Suppose if you want to seek a divorce on the grounds of the cruelty, you have to be very precise and have to state your prayer. If it is a vague prayer, then all of your money or all of your labor will get wasted in the coming years. So you have to be very much careful and preferably take the help of some experienced person, or take the help of some reference materials if they are available on internet. It's also been advisable to go through that materials, so that it will not going to suffer in the coming days. So after this, in interim relief, after the prayer clause, you have to verify all the contents of the you have made in the pleading. You have to verify it. Without verification, again, it's not been the petition suffers from the defects. And then after verification, you have to add the supporting affidavit. As you have seen, that nowadays it's not mandatory to file a supporting affidavit with every petition. This means you have to give us under the solemn affirmation. If something material facts is hiding, so you can be in trouble. So you have to disclose each and every fact in a transparent manner, and has to annex a supporting affidavit along with this petition. If you are claiming any interim relief, say suppose if you are a woman, if you are claiming the interim relief, you have to state that interim relief also either in the petition, or you can file a separate application. It depends upon the court rules. Some states allow, some states says to add, you can add only the interim relief inside the petition. If they do not allow you to file a separate application, you can add your interim relief above the prayer clause. So, and you have to, after this, the supporting documents must have to be indexed with proper index. So if any document is in your possession, you have to add the copy. Certified copy can be produced at the time when you tendered the documents, or the original copies can be produced at the time when you tendered the documents, but the copies of Xerox copies must have to be filed along with the petition. Now question arises, as I discussed earlier, para number 7. In the family court, whether advocates can plead on the behalf of the party. Yes, advocates are nowadays allowed to represent their party, but the party must have to be present on each and every day. Suppose if the party is engaged in some urgent work, then advocate can file an application for exemption, but advocates can't appear on the behalf of the party, but unless the party is present. So the basic purpose is that advocates can assist the parties in drafting the petition, take the notices, and can guide in a technical manner. So that's why the role of advocates are not totally barred, but the courts must have to be give directions that the application for seeking of engagement is allowed, then the advocates are only allowed. So advocates can represent with the counsel. So the courts writes in their order the petitioner in person along with the advocate, generally writes. Otherwise, what happens in other cases that learned counsel is on the behalf of respondent is present, or the other things are there. But the petitioner in person must be there along with the advocate. Then only can court can proceed and the matter on the daily proceedings of the case is conducted. So the next is the parade. What happens after filing of the petition in the filing order? So I hope this has much been clear. When you file the petition, you have to produce all the documents. You have to file file the sufficient amount of the copies along with the paper book. The paper book is required. The paper book you can file, or the file cover is required. You have to file the file cover along with the sufficient amount of the copies. The registry or the filing counter scrutinize your application if any material defect is there, if material alteration, defect is there on the petition. So for example, some dates are not mentioned, so numbering is not properly done, then the filing counter has the right to put some objection. You have to clear that objection. After clearing the objection, then only the matter get, after clearing the objection and scrutiny, then only the case get registered, and you will be granted a case number after clearing of all the defects. Then if you grant the case number, this means your matter is registered, so before the appropriate court. So then after registration, the matter is listed before the appropriate court. So first is the registration, for you have first is the filing, the scrutiny, thereafter is the clearing of the defects, and then registration, then listing of the matter before the appropriate court. So now question arises, what happens thereafter? The courts, when the matter is scrutinized and registered and listed before the court, first hear the version of the petitioner. Suppose if the petitioner is their husband, if he files a case before the family court, the court will first hear why you have been approached to this court, and may ask certain questions, may put certain questions on the petitioner. But in a routine manner, they issue the notices. So after the notices, which are returnable on specific day. So usually 3 months, 4 months time is to be granted so that it can be served in a correct manner. So the court will then issue notice and writes in their daily proceedings order sheet. So what our next question arises, what happens thereafter? What I have to do for serving of the notice? Yes, you have to serve the notice to the opposite party for this. Now, the notices can be served in various manners. It depends upon the court rules and the state where you have been residing. Nowadays, the notices are also being transferred electronically, but the usual process in the majority of the courts are either by the way of the process fees or by the way of speed post, courier, or the registered post. If the court directs you to serve the notices by the registered post, you have to deposit the envelopes, court fees, and the stamps, and etc., and along with the required number of the copies to the almuth or reader or the branch office where the such notices are processed for the serving on the respondent. And for process fees, there is a process fee form is also available in various court complexes. You have to fill that form, pay the required fee amount of court fees, usually 10, 20, 100, whatever is there. This depends upon the state where the court is, where the case is you have filed. So the almuth or the branch office will assist you in filling the process fee form. So a question arises, what happens thereafter? So after serving of the notice, what happens thereafter? If notices have been duly been served, and there are two options are there. Another one is the respondent deliberately doesn't appear. Suppose if the husband files the divorce case against the wife, and the wife refused to come before the court, so then court will first verify the receipt of the notice, whether the notice has been duly been served, then may proceed for the ex parte. Suppose if the notices are served on the party and the party deliberately avoiding to appear before the court presumes that the opposite party is not interested in contesting the case. Our opposite party has the full knowledge, so they may proceed for the ex party. So, and if the respondent appears, if the opposite party appears, so whether it's the husband or the wife, the court may send the file for the mediation. Now it's mandatory to send the file for the mediation. For every divorce case, mediation is very much essential. It's compulsory nowadays. So for every courts, insists the parties or directs the parties to go for the mediation before taking up the case for the divorce. Then before the mediation, you both again. Both the parties will have to appear, attend the mediation proceedings. The mediator or conciliator will try to conciliate both of you and may give counseling to the both of them. If the children are there, then they discourage the parties to go for the divorce so that the life of the children will not get affected, and or to adjust themselves so that the marriage could possibly be safe. So what happens when the respondent is treated an ex-party? The question arises whether it's a husband or the wife. If the court treats them as an ex-party, then the court doesn't close itself. The opposite, the petitioner will grants an opportunity to lead their ex-party evidences. After this, because the rule of the defense is struck down, but the petitioner again will have to prove his case. Without this process, the court will not grant him the divorce. But without the defense, without striking down the defense of the respondent, the court grants the opportunity to lead their evidences. So what happens if the mediation succeeds? The court records the statement of both the parties and close the case. If they agree for the mutual divorce, then grants the liberty to file a case to file the joint petition for the mutual consent. So what happens is that if they agree that yes, we are ready to separate, as you are, we don't want to contest again, we are agree for the mutual consent divorce, then the courts records their statements and grants them the liberty that you can approach to the appropriate court, to this court, and can file a joint petition for the mutual divorce. Or if they agree to stay together, then again the court records their statement, and then they records the statement specifically this statement is recorded that they are not under pressure or coercion to withdraw this case, so that they can thereafter they should not challenge this version that we have been forced to sign this statement. First they grants then the option that you are agreed in the mediation cell. Mediation cell too also recorded their statement. The court also records their statements. So what happens if the mediation fails? If the mediation fails, then court then proceed the case and put up for the further proceedings. So what happens now? Question arises: what happens thereafter? If the mediation fails, the courts put up the date for the further proceedings. Then courts directs the respondent to file the written statement, because the petition is already on the record, respondent has not countered the allegations there. If the respondent is not countering those allegations, then it means the petitioner with the version of the petitioner is accepted. So the court grants some time to the respondent to file their written statement, and also grants the liberty to the petitioner to file the replication order rejoined. Or it's called a replication. In the civil procedure code, the word replication is used, that means he is countering the allegations which have whatsoever been made by the respondent in the written statement. So after the petition is filed, written statement is taken on record, and then if the petitioner files the replication, then courts then the pleadings are complete. The pleadings after completed, what happens thereafter? The court will directs that the court will on specific particular day, the court will then fix the frames the issues and directs the parties to file the list of their witnesses. The first opportunity is granted to the petitioner to file a list of the witnesses. If they file the list of the witnesses, then the court may, on the request of the petitioner, to issue the summon. If he can brought the witnesses at his own, then the court grants the opportunity to the petitioner to bring the witnesses for the examination. If the petitioner wants that, the court should issue the notices to their witnesses. The court will issue the summons to the petitioner witnesses, especially if they are the independent witnesses. Then the day is then fixed for the petitioner evidence. After filing of the list of the witnesses, the court then fixes the date for the petitioner evidence. So a question arises: how the petitioner evidence is recorded? See, previously, by oral way, the witness will have to appear in the witness box and then give his testimony, and then this testimony is recorded. So it's a very time-consuming process. Nowadays, what happens, especially in the civil cases, evidence is by the way of the affidavit is recorded. So it means what happens in the evidence is by the way of affidavit. The party, the witness, will file the affidavit in the court, and which he has to tender in the witness box. Suppose if it is comprises, because it's very convenient for the court also, because everything cannot be recorded in just a short period of the time. The ample opportunity is granted to the witnesses to draft his examination in chief in the form of the evidences by the way of affidavit. So then the copy of the affidavit is also served to the opposite party. So the opposite party will then inspect the contents of the affidavit, and then the opportunity is also granted to the respondent to cross-examine the petitioner witnesses. So before cross-examination, opportunity is also granted to the witnesses to tender their documents. So tender, see, I have written there in the format, affidavit by the way of, what happens in the evidence by the way of affidavit. Everything is clear. The petitioner tendered his evidence by the way of affidavit and can tender his documents or the other materials. Suppose if he wants to tender some CD, some video clip, or in the any other materials, say USB and other any other materials is there, he can has the liberty to file all those materials in the form of the exhibits. So affidavit is generally marked. He's from the petitioner side, the evidences is marked in the form of PW1A. Suppose if it is petitioner witnesses number one. Suppose the petitioner witness is himself. The petitioner himself is a witness. So the marking of his document is in the form of PW1A. And suppose second witnesses appears, then it may be tendered in the form of PW2. And suppose the third witnesses come, PW3. So this is the format. This is the most appropriate terminology. It depends upon the court rules too, where states are usually being followed. First, you ask the parties to adopt these principles. So the affidavit is marked in the form of PW1A and exhibits. Suppose if he wants to tender 20 documents, so the marking of these documents are in the form of exhibits, which are in the form of exhibit P1, P2, P3, P4, P5, whatsoever. Can the opposite party can place the objections while tendering of their documents? Yes, the opposite party has the full right to made the objections in the form of admissibility, mode of proof, and the relevancy of the documents. Suppose if he is tendering the documents, the opposite party on the spot will have to record his objections that these documents are not admissible, these documents are not admissible on the mode of the proof or the relevancy. So the opposite party can record his objections at the time of the marking of documents. So though the family courts are not acting as per the Indian Evidence Act, but the principles of the procedurals are almost the same. So the opposite party can make their objections. So what happens after the tendering of the petitioner evidences? After the respondent has the right to cross-examine the petitioner. As I said earlier, when the petitioner witnesses tender his evidence by the way of affidavit and tender his documents in the form of exhibits, then opportunity is granted to the respondent to cross-examine on the contents made in the affidavit. But the cross-examination is also not limited to the points raised in the affidavit. He has the full right to ask any of the question, but the question must be relevant. It's not a vague or it's not very lengthy cross-examination. If it is not relevant to those issues, the court can can refuse to record the cross examination of the party. Then he can stop the cross examination to that level. The court can also restrain the respondent to limit his cross examination. Suppose if the questions are scandalous in nature or is not very much relevant in nature, the court can put some restraint on such cross examination. But the right of the cross examination is always be there. So can I receive the certified copies of the daily proceedings? Yes, you have the full right to obtain the certified copy of the order and the documents after allowing your application in the prescribed format through the court. Suppose the cross examination took place, if you want to see the cross examination, if you want to have the copy of this cross examination, you can file an application in the prescribed application format. Usually every court has got their own format. You can get the application format from the stationery shop located in the court premises and fill up the particulars and file the application after getting it allowed from the honorable court. So after, and then you have to pay the requisite fees. It's usually it depends upon 2 rupees, 3 rupees per page. So after, when the total bill is to be made, you have to deposit the money by the way of cash or by court fee stamps. So what happens after the cross-examination of the petitioner witness evidences? The petitioner witness is then discharged and fixed for another witnesses. And after the completion of the petitioner witnesses, the prosecution evidences get closed and listed for the respondent witnesses. Suppose there are 5 witnesses are there from the petitioner side. So as in a sequential manner, all their evidences are recorded along with the cross-examination. When both the examination chief is there, is recorded after cross-examination, re-examination may be there. If the petitioner wishes to re-examine any of the petitioner, and then after examination of 3-4 whatsoever the list, after the examination of all their witnesses, the court then fix the date for the closure of their petitioner evidence on any specific day. If the petitioner wishes to tender certain more documents, he's got the opportunity to file more documents at the time of the closing of the documents. But you have to satisfy the court why these documents could not be filed at the time, you have to satisfy the court that these documents were not there in his possession. So court may allow or may not allow to file those documents. So after closure of the petitioner evidences, then opportunity is granted to the respondent to file their list of their witnesses so that their examination is also recorded in the same manner as that of the petitioner. Only the terminology is different. So when the respondent evidences, the respondent tendered their documents, they are to be tendered in the form of RW1, RW2, or RW3. Only the terminologies are different. Otherwise, the procedural is totally the same. So after the closure of the respondent evidences, what happens after the closure of evidences? Then the court then fix the date for the arguments. After the closure of the petitioner evidences, after the closure of the respondent evidences, then courts then fix the date for the arguments. Arguments may also be supplemented by the written arguments, but courts ask the parties to lead their oral arguments. And if any of the party wishes to file the written arguments, he may file the written arguments with the leave of this court. So he can also be granted the opportunity to file the citations, to quote the citations, to file the citations, or if any of the parties relying upon, if they find that the ratio of the principle of their cases, of those cases decided by the appellate courts or by the higher courts, matches to that their cases, they have got the opportunity to present those citations before the court, so that court can also apply their mind at the time of the adjudication of the matter. So after after the completion of the arguments, then courts fixes the date for the pronouncement of the judgment. So see, after the judgment is pronounced, there are two options: either the petition is allowed or dismissed. So the host then fixes the date for the pronouncement of the judgment. And now question arises. There are large number of the queries are generally being asked. So the majority of the people, especially in the social networking sites, usually ask, suppose if my divorce petition is allowed, will it be final? Can I go for the marriage? No. Question arises, the decree will be final only if the respondent does not wishes to challenge in the High Court. So there is a limitation period is there. If the respondent appears before files the petition, first appeal petition before the High Court, and the High Court admits it, then it means the decree is under the challenge. So you have to wait for the till the expiry of the limitation period. So if the respondent does not wishes to file the challenge decree of the divorce, then it will become a final. But in the meantime, if suppose the respondent files the first appeal after seeking along with the application of the condonation of delay, the petition can also be entertained on the grounds which are beyond the control of the respondent. So if now the question arises, if my divorce petition is dismissed, can I file an appeal before the High Court? Yes, you have the full right to file the first appeal challenging the dismissal order of your divorce petition. The question arises, if my divorce petition is allowed in the family court and first appeal filed by the respondent is dismissed by the High Court, what other remedies are available to the respondent? Yes, there is only one remedy is available, is to file the special leave petition before the Honorable Supreme Court of India. So it means your divorce petition is allowed, first appeal filed by the respondent gets dismissed, then only the remedy is available is to file the special leave petition before the Honorable Supreme Court of India. So this is only the last opportunity granted to the respondent. If my divorce petition is dismissed by the family court and my first appeal is also dismissed by the High Court, then can I file the special leave petition before the Honorable Supreme Court of India? Yes, you have the full right to file the special leave petition before the Honorable Supreme Court of India, but it should be filed within the limitation period. Can I challenge the ex parte decree of the divorce? Yes, you can. It can be challenged, but you have to satisfy the court that there was sufficient cause to prevent you to defend your case. So there may a lot of reasons are there. Suppose majority of cases, what happens? Other party usually plays a fraud. They deliberately gives false addresses, or if they think the opposite party is not residing in India, is residing in another country, so they files cases and gives some wrong addresses. There may be the scope that opposite party mislead the court or supply the false information to the court about the residential address or other things, or if the respondent is in the coma or is hospitalized, could not appear due to certain reasons which are beyond his control. So he has to first satisfy the court that these are the conditions which are brought to me, which were before me. Any reasonable, prudent person is not in a position to contest his case. So he can file the application for setting aside the ex parte decree of the divorce. Suppose if the courts dismiss the ex parte of decrees by the divorce, is there any other option is available? Yes, you have the full right to file an appeal against the order which dismisses the decree of the divorce. Hope this video, you like this video. If you have any queries on this video, do you please put your comments in the comments box. And if you like this video, kindly subscribe to this YouTube channel so that the forthcoming video can easily be accessible to you. And kindly support this YouTube channel. Any quick queries are most welcome. Thank you for giving valuable time to this video. Thank you.